All right, I got the hoarse voice going on. I don't know if I'll be able to talk tomorrow. I might not have a voice tomorrow, so I'm going to go ahead and do this presentation like this. Yeah, some people calls it a sore throat. I calls it laryngitis. So I'm talking about bones and how they're related to kidney problems. However, on this version, I deleted out all of this stuff. And I just did the calculation stuff. If you want to watch the full version, it's going to be on YouTube. All right, let's talk about the GFR now. The pathology of kidney, whenever you're looking at GFR, you're looking at basically how many nephrons are still working. That's what GFR is going to tell you. And so by knowing how many nephrons are still working, we can give major categories. Now, this is only good for ages 2 and older, but these are the categories. If they got GFR greater than 90, they're good. Their filtration is either normal or is really high. I mean, they had a whole bunch of alcohol, these little 2-year-olds. I'm going to go ahead and let you guys know, based on the most recent mathematical calculations, we got a GFR that's at a G3A. And that's based on the updated Schwartz estimate equation.
What you got in there, good day? Reckon you can buy me some biscuits. You got any biscuits for sale in there? Mm. All right, then. Frank fried potatoes? Bible says two men ought not lay together. That don't mean well from it now.
So I think I just said this. I'm not going to beat a horse. Now here's a picture that I copied from our textbook. And this is actually a photo shot. So in this nephron, what is going on is we got volume coming out of here. Let me change this to black so we can see. We got some volume coming out of there. And we want to know how much volume. That's what GFR is telling us. It's giving me volume. How much fluid is being secreted out of the glomerulus into the Bowman's capsule as ultrafiltrate. The thing is, it's impossible to measure that because we can't come down here and measure what's coming out because we don't know if what's coming out is what came across that capsule because stuff can come in, stuff can leave, and so what comes out isn't going to tell me what came in there. But we got something called the law of conservation of mass. Basically what that says is that anything, not just liquid, but anything. So if a solid goes into this kidney, into this nephron, it has one option, it has two options. It can either stay in here or it can leave. And whenever it leaves, it got two options for that too. It can leave here or it can leave here. Now water, we can never know if it's, we can never just measure it because it's always going to leave. But we might be able to find a solid, a solute, that cannot get excreted here and can't get sent in here. That way we'd say for every bit of that, for every gram of that solid that came across here, that every gram of it's also coming out here. We got to find one solid that does that. And as long as that solid is something that the kidney does not synthesize, so the kidney doesn't synthesize it in the tubule, and the kidney doesn't metabolize it, because so those are other ways that it doesn't have to leave as that same solid. It can leave as a different molecule being incorporated, but it does have to come in, it does have to leave. So this is the law of what goes in must come out. And that particular solid we use is called inulin. Not insulin, but inulin. And you say, well, how does measuring a solid let me know how much liquid is coming across there? I'm glad you asked, because I can use a little trick called dimensional analysis. If I take the mass of something, divide it by the volume of something, that is the same thing as a concentration. So if I can measure the concentration of that solid in this blood right here, then I'll know the concentration of it that's getting filtered in here to begin with. Now, just knowing the concentration doesn't tell me anything, but if I take the concentration, which is a mass divided by a volume, and then I multiply that by the volume, which the volume that we're talking about is the filtration volume, or the GFR. So this is the GFR I'm talking about. At that point, these two units cancel, and I'm left with the mass. Well, you say, you still don't know what the volume is, so you can't cancel it. So far, you're right. But I can figure out what the mass is, because the mass that goes in is also the mass that has to come out. So, if I do that same trick on the urine, so the mass of that solid that is in the urine divided by the volume of that urine is going to give me a concentration. If I know the if I measure the concentration in the urine, and then I multiply it by the volume of that urine, then all of a sudden, I know the mass that went into the tubule. So now, out of all of these variables, I only have one that I don't know. Now we're going to play around a little bit more math and do something even better. So if I said that the concentration times the volume is equal to the mass, I did say that. And so if I say the concentration in the that gets filtered times the volume that gets filtered, which this will be my GFR, that equals the mass that gets filtered, that was filtered. I'll just call that mass 1. And the concentration of the urine times the volume of the urine, that's also going to, the volumes are going to cancel out, and that's going to give me the mass, which is mass 2. But we say mass 2 and mass 1 equal because mass can't be created or destroyed. And so now I can set these equations equal to each other. C1V1 equals C2V2. And this V1 is what I want to figure out. So I just take that concentration, number 1, and I divide it. And I get C2 times V2 over C1 is equal to the glomerular filtration rate. And see, this is an old chemistry trick. And so let me replace this with some letters you might be used to. So the GFR, that's my volume, is going to equal the concentration of a solute in the urine times the volume flow divided by the concentration of that substance in the plasma. Inulin costs a lot of money and it takes a lot of time to do. Some people don't like to do it. And some people just think math is kind of interesting, kind of fun, and so they like to do math, and so they find mathematical ways to not do tests. What I'm trying to say is we can use the creatinine to calculate an estimated glomerular filtration rate. The reason we can use creatinine is because so it comes from skeletal muscle and from food that you eat, but it goes into the blood at a basically at a constant rate. It gets freely filtered across the glomerulus and is not reabsorbed. It can be secreted though. So we're going to take a look at how to do this. And what we do, and I was going to do some more math here because there's some more cool math I can do, but I already got a lot of time going on to this lecture. So ask me on the side and I'll show you some even more cool math with this creatinine. So you can say that the clearance of creatinine is approximately the GFR. And this could be off by 10 to 40%. But to do the clearance of creatinine, you got to remember, you need to know the urine volume. Because essentially we're saying the clearance is equal to GFR. And so the clearance or the GFR is going to equal the urine concentration of creatinine times the urine volume flow divided by the plasma concentration of creatinine. Or this is usually written as capital C, SCR, serum creatinine. But remember, I'm lazy and I don't want to wait 24 hours collecting pee. And I don't know what happened to my slide here, but I had two different equations that were really good at solving for the GFR in adults, but they don't work on young kids very well, as I found out. And I can't show you those right now, but I have those in my study guide, and I also created an Excel spreadsheet, I'm going to show you in a minute. I also wanted to show you this fancy Schwartz equation because it's the one that actually works with kids. This equation has been updated three times. Well, it's been updated one time. There's three versions of the Schwartz equation. There's the original 1970s version, and because our ability to detect creatinine has become better, now the old equation from the 1970s it was based on failed or flawed creatinine assays, and so it doesn't work anymore. So in 2008, Schwartz got back on the drawing board, and him and a team put together two new equations. The first equation is one that's useful at the bedside because it literally requires you to remember this number, find out the height, and find out the serum creatinine, and that works for kids. And then there's an even better one that is not useful. So this one is useful at the bedside, and there's this way longer one, like 15 feet long, that I put on the study guide and I put in my PowerPoint, and it will calculate a little bit more accurate than this one. So here's, I made some Excel spreadsheets, and the reason I did that is I wanted to have a resource in the future where I could just pull it if I wanted to calculate creatinine or calculate GFR from creatinine. But the thing was, the first one I did, it was an adult one, and I realized that like 2 minutes after I made this, so I decided to just go ahead and make all of them, and not just the kid one, but all the adult and everything. So this one was from like the late 1970s, and it's still good because it's easy. Like, this is an easy equation to remember, but it also requires you to do three more subsequent equations, and so that makes it suck. Because this equation will give you creatinine clearance, it will give you absolute creatinine clearance, or basically an absolute GFR, but you always have to normalize GFR to 1.73 meters squared of body surface area, because if you don't, then you won't be able to compare it back to that table and see whether or not they're in renal failure. Last thing I want to point out was this equation is made for adults, and it's made for adults, and it's made for people that are not obese. So that's the thing to remember about this equation when you look it up: adults and not obese. It calculated this little girl's creatinine clearance at 110, which is way above being normal kidney. And this MDRD equation, it was created by studying 38 to 63 year olds, I think it was. And so whenever I plug her numbers into this, there's two different versions of this equation you can use based on updates that they've made to it. And my goodness, this girl's GFR is just outstanding. Now here's that Schwartz equation I told you that was good for kids. It's made for kids. And here's what you get from the bedside easy version. And here's what you get from the super advanced version. It's already normalized for you to 1.73 meters squared of body surface area. And so you don't have to do anything to come over here and compare it. You say, this fits in right here. This fits in right here. So both of these equations are basically going to get me to the same result. I will point out, however, that this advanced version requires the cysteine C. I didn't see that in our lab reports, so I just threw in the number 1 because I found the number 1 being reported, 1 milligram per liter, reported on a lot of stuff, and so I just threw in the number 1. Now, the reason I just went ahead and went with it because it was so close to the other one. And I know, while that's not evidence, that's, to me, that confirms something. I don't know what it confirms.